Stanford University.
All right, welcome to lecture number 11 of CS193P, the spring of 2016. Today it's all demo, okay? All demo all the time. We're gonna do a core data demo. And just to let you know what's coming up, because I won't come back to the slides, obviously. On Wednesday, we'll be talking about auto layout, and also we'll be talking about the final project requirements on Wednesday, okay? No Friday section this week, and then next week we'll start talking about animation. You have an assignment that's out now, which is number 5, which is a core data assignment, and then there'll be assignment 6, which will be an animation assignment, which will probably go out next Monday and do the Monday after. Maybe next Wednesday, do the Wednesday after, I'm not sure, but probably next Monday, and then that'll be your last assignment before the final project. Okay? All right, so let's talk about this core data demo that we're gonna do. We're gonna continue with Smashtag, leave off where we were before. Okay, here's the user interface that we had at the end of lecture 9, and you're probably very familiar with it because your homework builds on this. And we're going to build on this as well with this core data demo. What I'm going to do is add another table view controller here. Let's just drag it out. So here it is. And I'm going to segue to this table view controller from a bar button item in this existing table view controller, which is a little different. Like in your homework, you're segueing from the row. Here I'm actually going to segue from a little bar button item. Now, most of you have figured out that if you want to add a button to the navigation bar up here, you can't use this regular button that's up here. You have to use these bar buttons that are down towards the bottom. Here's one right here, bar button item. So I'm just going to drag it out and see if you drag it up at up on top of a navigation bar, then it'll jump in there. And what we're going to have this UI do is, I'm going to call this button tweeters, and we're going to have this MVC, this new one we're going to write today, it's going to show a list of all the tweeters who tweeted a tweet that we've ever downloaded with the search term that's in this MVC, right, our main MVC. So if we type hashtag Stanford here and search for some tweets and then we hit tweeters, over here we would see a list of all the Twitter users who tweeted those tweets with hashtag Stanford in there. Okay, not just in the most latest search of hashtag Stanford, but ever. And we're going to do this by having this core data database where every time we get a tweet, we're going to put it in the database. Okay? And so we can query those tweets and get all the information we want, including getting a list of the users who have tweeted. So of course, we will need a custom subclass of UI table view for this guy. So let's go ahead and create that. File, new file as usual, iOS source, it's a Cocoa Touch class. It's a UI table view controller. Also, we'll call this our tweeters table view controller because that's what's going to be in here, tweeters. We'll put it in the same group. We put all the rest of our stuff there. Okay, here's our tweeters. We're not actually going to keep any of this except, actually, I'll keep myself a row and index path here, but we'll get rid of the rest of this boilerplate that we get. Okay, so there's our tweeters table view controller. And we always want to make sure we go back into our storyboard and set with Identity Inspector this to be our tweeters table view controller, this guy right here. And let's go ahead and wire up this segue right here too. I'm just going to select this guy and control drag over to here. We're in a navigation controller, so we want show. If we were in a split view, we'd be show detail maybe. But here we're navigation, so we're going to show. Here's our segue. Let's give it an identifier. We'll call this the tweeters, we'll make this very verbose, tweeters mentioning search term segue. Okay, so that's what this segue does. When you click tweeters, it shows you all the tweeters that mention this particular search term, whatever that be, hashtag Stanford or whatever. Okay, so that's pretty much set up our UI right there. One thing that we need here is core data. We want to be able to access a core data database, so we need that manage object context. Remember, that's the hook that lets us in there. And I told you there's two ways to do that. One is UI manage document. I'm not going to demo that. That's extra credit, by the way, in assignment number 5, if you want to try and tackle that. The only thing difficult about that is the asynchronous stuff, but if you're got comfortable now with asynchrony. It shouldn't be very difficult at all. The other way was to use code that would get generated for you when you create a new project and turn on the core data button. And that's what I'm going to use. We started this project, and if we look in our app delegate, okay, this is Smashtag's app delegate here, you can see that it's got some empty methods in here, basically, with some comments about them. We'll be covering this stuff, by the way. This is part of what we call the application lifecycle, these methods. But there's nothing in here about core data, because when we created Smashtag, we didn't think we were building a core data app at that time, so we didn't switch that button. So no problem, though. I'm just going to create a new project and go File, New Project. Okay, and again, iOS application, single view, like we usually do. And you can call it anything you want. I'm going to call mine Foo. Okay, and just make sure that this button right here is switched, Use Core Data. Okay, and probably also want to make sure it's Swift, unless you're building something in Objective-C. And then when you click Next, put it anywhere you want. I'll put mine in my same place as always, Developer here. And it makes this Foo. Now, this Foo is just a blank app, right? It's got a blank view controller here, but we don't care about any of that. All we care about is in its app delegate, we look down, it's got all those same methods, but oh, starting here, core data stack, it's got a whole bunch of other code, okay? And we just basically want to pick this code up, so I'm just going to select it all, okay, starting from this mark core data stack going down to the end, and I'm just going to cut it out of here, copy or cut it, and I'm going to go to my app delegate back in Smashtag here, and I'm just going to paste it in. Okay? Now, it's not quite that easy. There's two more things we got to think about. You can see there are errors here. Okay, an error there, error here. That's because core data is in a separate framework. Just like the Twitter stuff you had is in a separate framework, so is core data. So you have to, at the top, anywhere you're going to be using core data, say import core data. Okay? So that'll get rid of all of our errors, okay, because of the types like NS Managed Object Model and NS Persistent Core Coordinator, things like that. But there's one more thing we have to be careful of here, and you're really going to want to be careful of this in your homework assignment, which is that this code that's get generated, it actually uses the name of the app as the name of the data model. You know that visual map we're going to make with all the entities and attributes things I showed you in the slides? It calls that thing the name of the app. So in this case, Foo, because that's what I called that other app. So you're going to want to change this to whatever you're going to call your mapping model, and you get to choose. So you can pick anything you want. The default happens to be model, okay? But you could also put the name of your app or whatever you want in here. Just make sure that whatever you put in here is the same thing as the name you pick when you create the mapping, okay, which we're going to do next. Okay, so that's it. So once you do that, you're going to get a few vars in here, but the main one that's of import here is this one, Manage Object Context. And so that's the thing, that's the hook that you're going to get into your database, right? Okay, so let's go ahead and create the schema for that database, and we do that with File, New, File. But here, instead of doing iOS Source, we're going to go down to iOS Core Data. Okay, and in here there's three things, and this is the one you want, data model, because that's what we're going to be doing. That's our description of our entities and attributes, our data model. Don't accidentally pick mapping model. It sounds similar, but it's different, okay? So data model is what you want. So we'll double click on that. Okay, you're going to get this. See, you can see the default is model. Just make sure this is the same as whatever you put in your app delegate, that code that you copied in. And make sure you put it where you want. Like, I really don't want this in supporting files, right? I don't want it down here in supporting files. I want it up at a higher level here at the Smashtag level, okay? So I'm gonna put that there. Hit Create. And it creates this empty map, okay? It has no entities yet, no attributes. Now, our app is going to have some Twitter users, gonna show Twitter users for that have tweeted a certain mention in a bunch of tweets. So clearly, we're gonna need an entity which is a Twitter user. And we're probably going to need an entity which is a tweet. So let's create our entities and see where it takes us. So I click this button down here, Add Entity, and it added this entity called Entity. And I'm going to double click on it to rename it. I'm going to call it Twitter User. Okay, so this is going to be the entity that represents a Twitter user in my database. Okay, I'm going to add another entity clicking down here. Okay, this one I'm going to call Tweet. So it's going to represent a tweet. Now, once we have these entities, we obviously need attributes on them. So a tweet, we're going to add text, which is every tweet has a text, 140 characters worth. You can see I have an error right up here. It says tweet text must have a defined type, and it's right now undefined. So I'm going to pick it to be a string. And I could add other things here. Maybe one thing that'd be really important with a tweet, when I'm fetching these tweets, if I typed hashtag Stanford and fetched 100 tweets, and then I typed hashtag Stanford and fetched another 100 tweets, it would probably be mostly the same tweets, maybe one or two new ones. So I need some kind of unique identifier in the database to identify a tweet so that I don't get all kinds of duplicates. I don't want, you know, the same tweet in there tons of times. So I'm going to call it unique. Luckily, we're going to find that the Twitter framework provides a nice unique ID that we can use to be unique our tweet, so that's good. And I could put other things in here, like maybe, you know, the created date of the tweet. Maybe I would call that posted, and you see I'm making the type here be date. These names don't have to match the names in the Twitter framework at all. In fact, the Twitter framework is completely separate. It has nothing to do with core data. It just gets the data from Twitter. Okay, it's our responsibility to take that data from Twitter and put it into this database with whatever attributes and entities we want. Okay, now we happen to call this tweet, and we also have a class in our Twitter framework called tweet also. We're going to have to be careful about that. But they're totally different. Okay, they represent the same thing conceptually, a tweet, but they're different classes. All right, our Twitter user, what does a Twitter user have? Well, a screen name, obviously. That's the most important thing. That's your Twitter handle, you know, @, whatever. That's a string. We don't really need much else for our app here, but maybe there's the actual name. We could have other attributes of a user, put whatever we want in here. Okay? Now, as time goes by, as you enhance your app, you're going to be adding more attributes, more entities, and that's perfectly fine. The only thing to notice is every time you change your model here, okay, the database that's on your simulator or on your device is now invalid. Okay? Now, there is a way to make compatible changes. I'm not really going to talk about that, but there is a way to do that. If you started shipping an app on the App Store, then that would start to matter to you because you'd want to ship a new version. Maybe it has some new attributes. You want all the data the user has created to still be good. But when you're in development and you're changing things, what you can do is just go onto your device or your simulator and delete your app. Okay, every time you change your schema, you're going to have to delete your app and then run again. Of course, you'll lose all your data in the database too, but that's just, you're doing development cycles anyway, so it probably shouldn't matter. Okay? All right, so we have this great thing. Let's take a look at it in the graphical view, clicking this little button down here, and you can see here's our two things. Notice if I move one, the other one kind of moves around to keep it all in a nice space here. And you can see here's my attributes, the name. The screen name, you can see that the inspector over here is showing us things like the type of it, right? Click on this one, type. You can even set some things like minimum and maximums for dates and things like that. I'm not really going to talk about this inspector. You can play around with it, certainly read the documentation and find out all the things you can do over here. But what I'm interested in now is the relationship between Twitter users and tweets. Okay, and we know that a Twitter user tweets and creates a bunch of these things, okay? Creates a bunch of tweets. So there's a relationship between these two. And anytime there's a relationship between entities in your data model, you just go to this graphical view, hold down Control, and drag between them, okay? And when you let go, you're going to get these new things. These are also going to be vars in your code, just like these are vars, which is a relationship between the two. And each side has a relationship, okay? And the first thing you'll want to do is rename these to be more meaningful names than new relationship. So a Twitter user's relationship to their tweets is probably going to be called tweets. It's the tweets that they've tweeted, right? And similarly, a tweet, the relationship it has to the Twitter user who tweeted it is probably, you could call it user or poster, or I'm going to call it tweeter, but it doesn't really matter. You know, it's just the name of a var that we're going to have in our code that represents the relationship between the two. Now, as we talked about in the slides about core data, there's something special about this relationship, this tweet's relationship to tweet, which is that a Twitter user can have multiple tweets, could have hundreds of tweets, possibly. Okay, a given tweet only has one tweeter, but a given Twitter user could have hundreds of tweets. So this relationship is a little different. So when we click on it here and look at it in the inspector, you'll see the inspector is pretty smart. It knows there's an inverse relationship, tweeter, over here. That's the inverse of tweets. And it also knows the type of connection here is 2-1. And we want to tell it, no, this is a too many connection, okay? Meaning there are many tweets per Twitter user. And when we do that to too many, you can see that the the arrow here gets double arrowed in this direction. Only this direction. It's still single to one in that direction, but it's too many in this direction. Okay, and that's perfectly fine for one to be a 2-1 and one to be a too many, as you can see here. You can also have both of them be too many. That's legal as well. All right. And we also know from the slides that what this means is that this tweets var, okay, on our Twitter user is going to be an NS set. And in that NS set are going to be NS managed objects. This is an NS managed object. This is an NS managed object. Okay. This var that points this way in tweet is going to be an NS managed object. Okay, because it's only a single one. Every single entity in the database is represented by an NS managed object. Now, that's a little bit kind of hard to use to have every single thing, Twitter users and tweets, be NS managed object, because the only way we can set the attributes is using that set value for key and get the attributes with value for key. It's a little unwieldy. So of course, we want to have subclasses of NS managed object for each of our entities. So a class called tweet, which is a subclass of NSManageObject that represents these things and has vars for all this, and the same thing for Twitter user. Okay, and again, remember from the slides, we can go up here and have, in the editor menu, Xcode generate those subclasses for us. One thing I'll remind you if you're gonna do this, see where it says model.xcmodel.d, see how that's selected? This menu, the editor menu, is context sensitive. It depends on what thing you have selected. So for example, if I go over here and pick storyboard, look, this menu is completely different. It's doing storyboard things over here, okay, like embedding and stuff like that. So you want to make sure you have this data model selected so that you get the data model editor menu. So we're going to pick create NSManaged subclass here, NSManaged object subclass. It's saying which of these do you want to create it for? We only have one, okay, so it's obviously selected, but you can actually have multiple of these mappings and have multiple databases. Here it's saying which of the entities do you want to generate subclasses for, and I'm going to click them both. Okay, I want both of these. Click next. Be very careful of this one. Okay, this is asking you where you want to put these things. Look where it wanted to put it, right at the very top of my workspace. I definitely don't want it there. I definitely want it somewhere in my SmashTag project, probably right at this level. Not in supporting files, but right here. Make sure you set this. You'll be unhappy if you put it up at your top workspace level. Okay, files won't be in the right place, and it'll be bad. Also, make sure your language is right, of course. This scalar, remember, that's all the things like integers and doubles are represented as NS numbers. Okay, and if you do the use scalars, the vars that it'll create will be not be NS numbers. It'll be ints and doubles. Okay, unfortunately, NS dates will be NS time intervals. I don't want that. I have an NS date in here, right, posted. So I'm not going to switch this. But if you change your mind on this, you can always go back and regenerate these. Okay, it's not like you generate these once and you're done. You can always go back. All right, so I'm going to hit create to create this thing. We'll see the files that are created. Okay, you can see right here, this first one is tweet. Okay, tweet.swift. It's a subclass of NS managed object, as we would expect. And this is just a place we can put any code we want. Okay, any code that in an object-oriented design sense would make sense to be in the tweet class. Okay, this is our place to do a thing. If we go back and regenerate these, this file will not get changed. Okay, so it won't stomp our whatever code we put in here. Okay, similar, we have Twitter user, okay, right here. Same thing, okay, just a place to put Twitter user. It's a subclass of NSManaged object. And then there are these two really cool extensions that were created for us, okay, one for Twitter user and one for tweet, that have vars that represent each of our attributes, so we don't have to do set value for key. Okay, you can see screen name is a string, name is a string, tweet, as promised, is an NS set, and in that NS set we NS manage objects. In fact, they'll be tweets, okay, a subclass of NS manage object. Notice that they're all optional. That's because when we create a Twitter user, in this case, in the database, all the attributes will be nil. Okay, we set them to whatever we want. And similarly for tweet, okay, it's got an extension as well, you can see. And notice its tweeter relationship is a pointer to a Twitter user, exactly like you expect. If you do this and you find this to be NS managed object, okay, it could be because your tweet and Twitter user files got generated in the wrong order, so that Twitter user hadn't been generated at the time tweet was, and so it gets NS managed object. The fix is just go back and regenerate them again, okay, because it takes into account what is generated in the past. Okay, otherwise, it's all pretty straightforward. Now, these files you never edit. These files get regenerated every time you go into that create NSManage object thing. So as you change your schema, these might change. All right, now I like to take all of these core data things, okay, including my model file, and I like to put them in their own group. So I'll select them all and say new group from selection and call it core data. So this is my core data group. Inside this group, I got all my stuff that has to do with core data, and we're going to add a little bit more to that in a minute. All right, so back to our app and what we're trying to accomplish here. All right, so here's what our app looks like, right? Just got this thing that's going to segue. There's really two parts to making this new MVC work. One is we have to put data in the database. That's actually something this MVC does, because it's the thing that does the fetching. When we type hashtag Stanford, it's the thing that goes out and gets them. So this is going to load up the database with tweets and Twitter users. And then this one is going to look in the database, okay, to find things out. So let's do this part first. Let's go to our existing tweet table view controller and have it update the database every time we do a fetch. All right? So here's our code for our tweet table view. Hopefully you remember this, very intimately familiar with it. There's our search text. Here's where we're doing our search for tweets, right? Here's where we find new tweets and insert them in the table. So I'm just going to, in addition here to putting them in the table, I'm going to call some method, let's say update database, and pass along these new tweets to go put them in the database. All right? Now, we're going to be doing core data here, so I want to make sure I import core data up at the top here. Okay? And then I have to write this method here, private func update database. Okay? It takes the new tweets that it got, which is an array of tweet, but now I have to be careful here, okay? Because which tweet is this? Is that the tweet in the Twitter framework, or is that this tweet right here that's an NSManaged object? Mm-hmm. Okay, we have to be careful here. And the way we distinguish the two is by putting the framework name in front. So this update database takes Twitter tweets, and we're going to put them, turn them into NSManage object tweets and put them in the database. So we need to be careful if you do that. Now, when you do your homework, you're welcome to not call this thing in your database tweet if you don't want to have to deal with twitter.tweet. Okay, you could call it something else. But if you do call it tweet, then you want to make sure to distinguish which ones you're talking about at any given time. All right? Now, to update our database, here's where we need that NSManage object context, right? That little hook that lets us put things in the database, search through the database, et cetera. I'm actually going to make that part of the model of this MVC. Because if you think about what this MVC does, yeah, it lets you search, but it also updates that database. Which database it updates is really part of describing its model. Okay, so I'm going to have a var here called managed object context. It's going to be an NS managed object context, and it'll be optional. And if this is nil, this is not set to anything, then I just won't update any database. Okay, so I'm going to write my code so if this is nil, I'm not going to update any. I'll still do my searching, but I'm not going to update any database. So if anyone wants me to update a database, they better set this, okay, to the database they want me to update. Now, especially for demo purposes, I'm actually going to have this have a default, which is that app delegate thing. Remember that code we just copied over into app delegate over here, this managed object context? I want to call this property, or get access to this property on my app delegate to get the managed object context. Again, if you're using a UI managed document, you'd be doing this differently. Okay, so I got to call that. And if you remember how that code goes, we're going to get UI applications shared application. So this is just an instance of UI application that's shared throughout your whole app. It's the only one you're ever going to use. And then I'm going to get its delegate. Okay, now its delegate is of type UI application delegate, right? It's a protocol. You know how delegates work. It's always a protocol. And we don't want that. Okay, we want it to be this particular app delegate class right here. Okay, this app class app delegate, kind of generic name app delegate, it happens to implement the UI application delegate protocol, so that's good. Okay, so that means I can go over here and say as app delegate. Okay, so now I have a hold of that app delegate instance. All right, and all I need to do now is send it managed object context. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to put a parentheses around here. Now this might be nil. Okay, what if the delegate is for some reason not set, or what if it isn't this class app delegate for some reason. You change it mid-flight, okay? Then I'm going to optional chain here and get the managed object context. Okay? So this all might come out nil. That's okay because this is an optional, and then we just won't put anything in the database in that case. All right? Now it's a little weird to have this default. More likely you would just have this be nil and someone would have to explicitly set it, but that would require us probably to create a little subclass of TweetTableView called RootTweetTableView, and it would do this line of code and then call super.managedObjectContext equals this. Okay, and then we would go in our storyboard and we would set the identity inspector for this table view to be root table tweet table view controller. But that's a little more than I want to go through in the demo here. So we're just going to kind of go cheap mode here and just make it default to be this managed object context. All right, so this is where we're going to store our database when we our information when we do this update database. Okay, now remember, anytime we access the database, we have to do it with that perform block. Because these managed object contexts are only thread safe within the thread they were created on. And I'm going to write all my code in this demo as if I don't know what thread these managed object contexts are created on, even though we know that that app delegate one is always a main queue one. But I'm not going to write my code assuming that, just so you can see what it looks like to write multi-threaded managed object code, okay? So that means we always have to have our managed object context and do perform block. Okay, now if this is nil, what happens here? Nothing. Good, that's what I want. Okay, if I don't have a managed object context, I don't want to update the database. So this is perfect so far. All right, so we're going to perform a block here. Inside this block, all we got to do is put these new tweets, okay, into the database. So that's pretty straightforward. I'm just going to have a little for loop that goes through those tweets, say for Twitter info in the new tweets. And then here I have to, you know, create a new but unique tweet in the NSManageObject sense with that, you know, Twitter info. Okay, so that's what I need to do in here. So I need a method to do that. Now, that method really doesn't want to go in this tweet table view controller. Okay, that's really something that wants to go in the tweet class. Okay, the tweet class is one-stop shop for everything tweet when it comes to the database. So if you had a method that takes Twitter info from the network and turns it into a tweet in the database, that needs to live in the one-stop shop. Okay, so we're going to actually put that code, some method that does this, in tweet. Okay, remember tweet is this subclass of NSObject. So we're going to do exactly what that comment just said and insert the code we want in here. Now, this code, what is this method going to do? Well, this method is going to look in the database, and if there's already a tweet there with that unique ID, then it's going to just return that. If not, it's going to create one and load it up with the Twitter information, okay, that it got from over the network, and then it's going to return that. So it either looks it up and returns it, or it creates it if necessary. Okay, I'm going to call this thing, first of all, it's going to be a class function, meaning I'm going to send this to the tweet class because I'm creating an instance here. I can't really send it to an instance yet. I haven't created one. I'm going to call this thing tweet with Twitter info, and it's going to take some Twitter info, which is going to be a Twitter.tweet. Okay, so I have to import Twitter here because I'm making a Twitter.tweet. And the other thing I got to have if I'm going to create something in the database is in managed object context. Okay, I have to have the NS managed object context that you want to create this thing in, or I can't create it. Okay? And this thing is going to return a tweet. Okay, it's either going to return the tweet that it found in the database by looking at the unique ID of this Twitter tweet, or it's going to create one in the database and return that. Okay? So let's have it return nil. Actually, let's make it so it returns an optional tweet in case for some reason we can't create one. We'll have it return nil by default. Okay, we'll get back to how we're going to implement this in a second. I want to go back to the code that calls this, which is here, okay, this update database, and use it here. And so you just call, you know how you call class functions? You just have the name of the class, tweet. And then this is tweet, what's it called? Tweet with Twitter info, and we're going to pass the Twitter info along. Okay, this is the Twitter info that we're pulling out of this array of twitter.tweets, right? In a for loop here. And in managed object context, we're going to pass our own managed object context. And we can go ahead and unwrap it because we know we wouldn't have made it into this block if this were not nil. Right? And notice that it's complaining here about you got to put self in, you got to put self in front of this because this right here is a block. Okay? So we got to make sure we avoid any loops, you know, any memory cycles. And what else is it complaining about here? I must have typed that wrong. Let's go back here. Go back here to tweet. I forgot to put context. Okay, in this manage object context right there. All right, back. All right, so we got this. So this is now one thing that's interesting about this tweet with Twitter info. It returns a value, right? It returns a tweet. Now I don't care. I don't want the tweet here. I'm just creating it. I'm the guy loading the database, so I don't want that tweet. So notice that Swift doesn't complain, even though I'm ignoring it. But some would say it's pretty good code to say underbar equals here. Okay? That tells someone reading this code, yeah, I understand that this returns a value, but I'm not interested in it. Remember the underbar in Swift is the universal, I don't care about this thing. Okay? So it looks a little odd to do this, but some would say this is a little bit better coding style. It's just, it makes it a little clearer to people reading your code that this is what you intend. Okay? Now, this will, once we implement this, this will load up the database with these tweets, but it's not going to save that database. Okay? Now, if we're using a UI managed document, okay, then it would all be auto-saving, fine. But here we're using the AppDelegate one, and even if we're not sure which one we're using, it can't hurt to save, okay, the context in the UI managed document case. So how do we save? Well, it's simple. We just say managed object context, save. Okay? But of course, we're going to have an error here because it's going to say, hold on a second. First it's saying we're inside a block, so we have to do self, so we'll do that. And we still have another error, which it says this call can throw, but it's not marked with try. So Swift is saying, hey, pay attention, this can throw. So we need to put try in front. And of course, if we're going to try something, we need to put it inside of a do loop and catch any errors that come out. Okay, and we'll put it in a local variable called error. This is going to be an NS error instance. Okay, we could look at the error code, et cetera. I'm just going to go ahead and print it out. I'm going to say core data error, something like that. This is bad. You wouldn't want to do this in your real code. Okay, it's just demo ware here. You would want to decide what you wanted to do if you tried to save and it failed for some reason. Okay, so. So this is going to save it. And this will work, again, even if you're in an auto-saving UI managed document, it's going to work just fine. Okay? All right, let's jump back to where we were over here, tweet, and implement this thing, tweet with Twitter info. So I said that what tweet with Twitter info is going to do is first it's going to look in the database and see if it can find this twitter.tweet. Okay, in the database already, and if so, it's going to return it. So how do we look in the database and find something? Well, we use this NS fetch request thing. Okay, so we're going to make a fetch request. Okay, it wants to know the entity name. So here we're looking for tweets in the database. Okay, so we got this fetch request. So I'm going to assign that to a local variable here, let request equal, and this request needs a predicate that says which tweet do you want? So I'm going to say, okay, my predicate is NS predicate with the format, and I'm going to say that the unique ID of this tweet equals something. And what is that something? Well, it's the whatever the unique ID is in twitter.tweet, okay, which happens to be called ID. So I'm going to get my Twitter info.id. Okay, so that this is just a property. You might not have used it with your homework number 4, but it's just a property that uniquely identifies this tweet. Okay, so I'm going to go look in the database and see if I can find that. And the way we look in the database is we say let, I'm going to say query results, just a local variable, equal the context that we're supposed to look in here, that's this context up here, dot execute fetch request. and then you give it that request. Okay, so that's how we look in the database. But there's some problems with this, as you can see, little errors over here. One is that this thing throws. Okay, execute fetch request throws. So I need to say try. Okay, so that's problem number one of this. And if I'm going to try, then of course I need to do a little do loop here and catch any errors. Now, if I'm executing this fetch request to look for this tweet and it's not there, what am I going to do? There's really nothing I can do. I just continue and try and create it. I'm going to assume it's not there, right? If I search for it and I don't find it, I'm going to assume it's not there. So basically when I catch an error, I'm just going to ignore the error and move on down here to keep trying to create it. But if I am able to find it right here, okay, if I do get a result there from doing this fetch, then I'm going to say if I can let the tweet that's in there equal the query results. Now remember, the query results are an array of tweets, all the tweets that match my predicate. My predicate is unique, so there should only be one in there, either one or zero. Okay, there's one in there if it found it. There's zero of them in there if it didn't find it, right? So I'm going to go use this method in array called first. Okay, that returns the first item in the array or nil if the array is empty. So it never does array index out of bounds. So it's kind of a cool, there's also last, but first is kind of a cool one. And when I pull it out of there, of course, it needs to be a tweet. Okay, so if I can pull the first thing out of this result array and it's a tweet, I'm good to go. I can just return that tweet. Okay, otherwise, I couldn't find the thing in there. I got to go create it in the database. Everybody cool with this code? Now, this is unfortunate, a lot of code. Okay, 7 lines of code here. This can all be done in 1 line of code. Okay, so let's look at that. How can we do that? And this is requires you to start getting more and more familiar with optional chaining. Okay, because we've got a lot of things that can go wrong here. Okay, things can be nil, all kinds of things happening right here. So, believe it or not, we can do this just by doing this. If let tweet equal, we're going to try, and if we fail, return nil. Try question mark means try it, and if it fails, return nil. To ask our context to execute this fetch request, okay, this same fetch request we just did, okay, if that is successful, then go on to get the first thing in the array and see if you can cast it to a tweet. Okay. That is identical to this. Okay, and it reads a little more simply, a little more like English, okay? Try to use the context to execute this fetch request, get the first thing, and if you can get this first thing as a tweet, then return it. Okay? So it's actually better code, I believe, more readable than the other. Yeah.
So where would like the catch on the upper one?
Yeah, so we can't do this if we're going to catch. If we're going to catch and do something, here we ignore, so we didn't do that. But if we were going to catch and do something, then we would have to use this more verbose way of doing it. Good question there. All right, so we got that. Okay, so what if we can't? Okay, what if we could not find the tweet in the database? Now we need to create the tweet. Okay, so I'm here, I'm going to say if, I couldn't create it, so I couldn't look it up. So if I can create it, which is, if you'll remember from the slides, NS entity description dot insert new object for entity for name. Okay, we're creating a tweet. The manage object context is context. Okay, and we obviously want it to be a tweet. Okay, so here we've created the tweet if we're able to. Okay, it's an if let, so we're going to see if we can create it by inserting something in the database. Everybody cool with that line of code? Pretty simple. All right, now we've created a tweet, but it's empty. Okay, everything's nil in there. So we need to start setting some of the values. Like, really importantly, we better set that unique equal to the Twitter info's ID. Okay, make sure it's unique. We also want to set the tweet's text equal to the Twitter info's text. I think we also had the tweet posted, which would be the Twitter info's created. Okay, so we just want to go through here and grab the information that we got from the network and put it in the database. That's basically what we're doing here. Okay? Now, what about this one? Tweet.tweeter equals. Oh, how do we do that? Got to set up that relationship between Twitter and tweets, okay? Well, to do that, we have to create the Twitter user that goes for this, okay? And by that, I mean this Twitter user right here, this NSManageObject Twitter user, okay? And to create a Twitter user, I'm going to use the exact same kind of code that I just was in the middle of typing in tweet. I'm going to type it in really fast because it's exactly the same, okay? So I'll go through it here, but it's exactly the same. So I need to import Twitter, just like I did in that one. So here we're in Twitter user, okay? And this one's called Twitter user with Twitter info. This time the Twitter info is not a twitter.tweet, it's a twitter.user. Okay, and we still have to pass the manage object context, and it returns a Twitter user if it can find one or create it. Okay, now for a Twitter user, the unique is the screen name. Every Twitter user has their own unique screen name, so we don't have a unique, we just use the screen name as the unique thing. Here we're doing that try to see if we can find it. If we can, we return it. If we can't, we're inserting a new one, okay, and setting the screen name and the name and returning it. Okay, now notice that I'm not setting the tweets NSSet. I'm not adding anything to the tweets NSSet here. Okay? That's because I, at this point, I don't know any tweets that are in the NSSet. So I'm just creating a Twitter user that so far has no tweets in the database. Okay? When I create. All right? Now let's go back here to where we're creating the tweet. And now to set this tweet.tweeter, all we need to do is say Twitter user with Twitter info, and now we pass the user, which is the Twitter info dot user, and in managed object context, in managed object context, the context, okay? This creates that tweeter, that Twitter user, okay? And sets it to this var, which is that relationship. The NS set in the Twitter user will have this tweet automatically added to it. Okay, you don't have to do both sides. If you do one side, it does the other. If I had put a tweet in the Twitter user's NSSet, the tweeter would have been set to it. Okay, if you touch one side, the other side gets kept in sync. That's an awesome thing about Core Data. So you never have to worry about database integrity. It manages the integrity all the time for you. Okay, very important to understand. All right, so we got it. So as long as we were able to do either look it up or create it, we can return it. Okay, oops. Return the tweet. Otherwise, if we couldn't do either of those things, then we'll just return nil. Okay, very unlikely because this almost never fails. Inserting a new object, it's going to work virtually 100% of the time. Okay, got that? All right, so back to where we were calling this right here. Everybody cool with this? You can see how this is going to put this array of tweets, okay, into the database. That. All right. Now let us let's go ahead and before we do our new MVC, let's just make sure this is working. Okay. I'm going to write a little function here that prints out what's in the database, how many Twitter users, how many tweets. Let's just see if this is working. Okay. So let's write that function. See what that would look like. So I'm going to have a private func. I'm going to call it print database statistics because it's basically going to just print how many of Twitter users are and how many how many tweets and how many Twitter users. So of course we have to perform this in a block, okay? Because we always have to do that when we're doing manage object context stuff. And I'm going to watch this. If let results equal try to execute on our context. And actually, we can exclamation point that. Execute a fetch request. Now watch, I'm going to create a fetch request on the fly here. Fetch request with an entity name. And what am I looking for here? OK, let's count the Twitter users first. So Twitter user. Now notice I have a fetch request here with no predicate. I just created an NS fetch request with no predicate set on it. That gets all Twitter users. If you have a fetch request without a predicate, it means give me all of them. OK, all of whatever the entity is. That you're looking for, okay? So if I'm able to do that and get the results, then I'm just going to print that we have results.count, however many we got here, Twitter users. Okay, so that's this little code right here. will print out how many Twitter users are in the database. All right, now there's actually a better way to do this because this is a bit of a problem. When I execute that fetch request, it gives me every single Twitter user out of the database and into my memory. Now, they're just husks because remember I talked about the faulting thing? So the attributes like the Twitter user screen name and name, those aren't pulled from the database, but like a little husk is there. And if I had thousands of Twitter users, that would be unnecessarily thousands of bytes being pulled into my memory. Okay, so there's a better way to do this. There's actually an execute a fetch request equivalent, which only counts how many things there are, and it counts it on the database side without pulling everything over and counting it in an array. So for the Twitter, for the tweets, I'll use that way of doing it. Okay, and that looks like this. I'm going to let tweet count equal our context manage object count for fetch request. It's called. Okay, instead of execute fetch request, it's called count for fetch request. I'm still going to create a fetch request on the fly here, and this time I am in this fetch request entity name. This time I'm searching for tweets, not Twitter users. Notice there's this little error pointer right here. You see this error pointer? This is an interesting method. I'm not sure why it does this way, but instead of throwing the error, it actually returns it through a pointer. And if you're not interested, you can just say nil. Say, I don't want the any error information. Okay? So it's kind of an odd little method in that way. But that's going to return the tweet count, and now I can just print the tweet count tweets. So this is better code right here than this. Okay? It's going to be much more efficient. I'll leave them both in here so that when I post the demo, you can see the difference. I'll even put a comment in here, a more efficient way to count objects. Okay, but they're both just counting. This is counting the number of Twitter users. This is counting the number of tweets. Okay, so let's call this print. Every time we update the database, let's go ahead and call this print database statistics thing. And I'm actually going to put a little print in here saying, done printing database statistics. Okay, I'm going to put this in here because something interesting is going to happen with that print. Okay. All right, let's go ahead and run. Okay, now we should be loading up the database with Twitter users and tweets every time we search for something on hashtag Stanford. We're not showing any of it yet, but hopefully we'll be loading up the database. Okay, we'll set our prototypes here when we get to that. So here's our segue. You see our table here is empty. We haven't done anything to implement that MVC, so it's just a blank MVC. But if we do hashtag Stanford, okay, it searches, and we'll see down here in our console that it had 100 tweets, which is right, because remember here in our code, we fetch 100 tweets, okay? So that's doing that properly. And it's only 75 users. Why is that? Well, probably there are people in here who are tweeting more than once, okay? Numerous people, like here, this guy, I am not the clone, okay? He's tweeted twice right there, so he's only counted once. So that sounds right, that there's 75 and 100. Now, here's a very important test to make sure things are working. I'm going to look for hashtag Stanford again, and I better not get 200 tweets. There it is, only 100. So nobody even tweeted to Stanford. One of you maybe tweeted. I don't know. Make it work for us here. Okay, let me try something else. How about hashtag SF Giants? I believe they're playing right now. Okay, now we have 200 tweets because we searched for something different, okay, this time. So we've got the 100 tweets from Stanford and 100 tweets from Giants. So I'm going to do Giants again. Still nobody tweeting. Nobody's interested in the Giants or in Stanford currently, I guess. There we go. Somebody finally tweeted something new for the Giants. Okay, so now we have 201 tweets. Okay? Doesn't sound like things are going well for the Giants. Hope I didn't spoil it for anybody. Okay, so we got our thing working right here. Look at this though, done printing database statistics. That's printing out before it prints. Isn't that weird? This print is definitely after print database statistics. Why is this printing out before? Anyone have an idea? Begins with an A. Asynchronous, yeah. Okay, this stuff, these perform blocks, both this perform block right here and also this perform block up here, happen asynchronously. These blocks just get put onto their queue. In this case, it's the main queue, but it doesn't matter, whatever the queue is, and they get put on that. So when I do print database statistics, it does this line of code, which returns immediately. It instantly returns. It puts that block on some queue and returns immediately. It doesn't wait to execute this code because this is not perform block and wait, it's just perform block. So this goes, returns immediately, and then this prints out immediately. Then later, this block gets pulled off onto the queue, the main queue, and run and does its thing, which causes this output. Okay? See why I put this in here so you understand that? This is happening asynchronously. Unless you say perform block and wait, it's asynchronous. All right. Now, we got the data in our database. Excellent. Now we can go on to back to our storyboard right here. And we can implement this MVC, okay, this new MVC of ours. We need to do some things to do that. We need to make sure that we have, for example, a reuse identifier for this cell. So what is that cell? It's basically a Twitter user, so I'll call it Twitter user cell. We want these probably to be subtitle, okay, instead of custom cell. We don't need custom cells for any reason. Oops. We can make sure we have our identities for the whole table. We do. That's all looking good. We can make sure we have this set, okay, which we do. Okay, so it's all good. All right, so we're all ready to basically implement this guy's class, his custom subclass. So let's go take a look at that. That's right here. Whenever we implement a new MVC, a great thing to do, and I think this is the fourth time I've said it in this class, come up with this model first. Try to understand what this thing is actually doing by understanding its model. Now, this is a very simple MVC. It takes some mention, like hashtag Stanford, and it searches for all the users, okay, who have tweeted that, okay, in our database. So a clear, very important part is that mention. Okay, whatever that mention is, hashtag Stanford, that clearly needs to be part of our model. Okay, without that, we can't do anything. But another really important part of the model is that database. Okay, without that database, I can't look this mention up. Okay, so another one is a managed object model, just like our other one actually had that part of its model as well. Okay, that's a in its managed object context, NS managed object context. Okay, I'll have that be optional, but to be frank, if that's nil, I'm gonna have an empty table. Okay, because this time it really demands that. If either of these change, I'm going to do a did set here and update my UI, which basically means I'm going to have to reload my table. Okay, so I'll do that for either of these. And then, of course, I need a private func update UI. Okay, and in here, we're going to have to use this information. Okay, it's complaining here because we have to import core data. Okay, notice that this particular MVC does not import Twitter, okay? Because it's purely using the database. The other MVC used Twitter and the database. This one only uses the database, so it doesn't import Twitter, just core data. All right, so we'll get to update UI in a second. One thing I want to do before that is do our prepare for segue and set these two things, okay? So we have to do our prepare for segue back in this MVC over here, okay? So let's go back to that MVC. We'll put it right here. Prepare for segue. This prepare for segue, by now, prepare for segue should be old hat for you guys. You've done so many segues, but we're just going to check to see if the segue's identifier is right. That's going to be, what did I call that thing? I can't even remember now. Let's look in our storyboard. This was called, I'll even copy and paste, tweeters mentioning search term. Okay, so if it's the tweeters mentioning search term segue, then I need to get the destination view controller as a tweeter table view controller. So I'm going to say if I can let the tweeters TVC, we'll call it, equal the segue's destination view controller as a tweeter table view controller. Okay, so I've got a hold of it. Now I can just set the public API, the model of this. So it's got the mention, which is just our search text, right? And actually, we don't even need to do that. It's our search text. And tweeters tvc.managedObjectContext is our managed object context. Okay, so we just prepare. So that's all we're doing here is prepare. Now that. Okay, now back to here, update UI. So how are we going to update this UI? We need to have this table, and we need to make it full of Twitter users who have tweeted a tweet that has this mention, like hashtag Stanford in there or whatever. Okay, how are we going to do that? Well, we're going to use NSFetchedResultsController, that really cool object I told you about at the end of the last lecture. And that is an object that basically just glues an NSFetch request to a table view. And that's exactly what we want here. We're going to create an NSFetch request, which fetches the Twitter users we want. Then we're going to glue it onto this table. Okay, and that way, anytime the database changes in a way that those users would change, it's going to automatically update the table. And we don't have to do anything else. Okay, now let's remind ourselves how NSFetchRequestController, how it works. Okay, it's got two pieces to it, and I'm going to have both of those pieces implemented for you using this class that you're going to be able to use for your homework. It's right over here called Core Data Table View Controller. So let's drag this Core Data Table View Controller. I'm going to put it in my Core Data group right here, and I copy it in. Okay. All right. So let's take a look at this thing and see how NSFetchedResultsController works. So here's Core Data Table View Controller. It's a subclass of UI Table View Controller. You're going to make it be a subclass. You're going to make it be the superclass of your UI Table View Controller. So back here in our tweeters table view, instead of inheriting from UI Table View Controller, I'm going to inherit from Core Data Table View Controller. That way, I'll get everything you get from UI Table View Controller, but I'm also going to get this NSFetchedResultsController stuff, okay? So let's look at that some more. There's two parts to the NSFetchedResultsController. One is that I can use the NSFetchedResultsController to implement my entire UI Table View data source, except for self-erode index path. Okay, you still have to implement that. But all the other ones, look, number of sections in table view, number of rows in section, even the section titles, right? The header titles and footer titles, section indexes, all this stuff. It implements all that stuff. See how the implementation of these is all using the fetch results controller? So that's part A of how the NSFetchedResultsController works. Part B is that the fetch results controller has a delegate, okay? And that delegate can implement these methods that will be called anytime the database changes. So anytime anything happens in the database that might affect this NSFetch request, okay, the delegate, the NSFetchedResultsController delegate, is going to be called and sent these messages. And look what these things do. They just update the table view. See, table view insert rows, delete rows, you know, reload rows. That's because, you know, this is because something got deleted from the database. This is something got inserted in the database. This is something changed in the database, okay? So that's part two, is this delegate of the NSFetchedResultsController. So I've given you the codes to do both those things, okay? To implement this delegate and also to implement all of this UI table view data source. All you have to do is set this var in the Core Data Table View Controller, which is an NSFetchedResultsController. And all that happens when you set this var in did set is it sets itself as the delegate so that all these methods down here at the bottom will work, okay? Then it tries to perform the fetch, okay? If it catches it, it'll report an error if there is any. And then it reloads the table, and that's it, okay? The fetch results controller is going to automatically be linked now. So all you have to do to use Core Data Table View Controller is set this fetch results controller. You have to create and set one of these, and then it'll just work by magic, okay? So let's go back here and do exactly that. In our update UI, we need to say self.fetchedResultsController equals, we don't actually need to say self dot, but I just want to emphasize that it's something we're inheriting from core data table view. Okay, we need to set our fetch results controller to something. So we're going to create a new fetch results controller. Okay, and here are what all of the things in the initializer look like. Okay, first there's the request. This is the NSFetch request that it's going to glue on to the table view. Okay, we'll have to create that in a second. Second is the context. So we have to give it what context, what database are we looking in. Next is this section name key path. Okay, NSFetchedResultsController will do the section titles if you have a attribute in the entities that are in the table that you're looking up here, which is the section. Okay, the string that represents the section. You can call that attribute anything you want. and you put the name of it here, whatever name the section attribute is here. The only thing about this, and you can put nil if you don't have sections, which we don't. The only thing about this is that your table must sort in the same order as these sections would sort. I mean, think about it. If you're going to have them grouped by section, the things need to be in the same order. Otherwise, you'd have some things in a section here, some in a different section, another different section. You can't have that. They have to sort in the same order. Okay, so sometimes you'll have your sort descriptors of your fetch request maybe sort by the section first and then sort by whatever you want to do. That's an easy way to make it work. And then there's the cache, which we're also not using. Okay, and that's just a name, that's a string to represent it. So I'm even going to put this so we can really see these four arguments right here. Okay, so we need to do a request right here. And we need to do the context. Okay, well, the context is easy. That's part of our model. So I'm just going to say, if I can let the context equal my own managed object context, okay, then this will be good to go here. Otherwise, I'm going to set my fetch results controller to nil. If you set your fetch results controller to nil, core data table view controller will clear your table. Okay, which is what I want if I don't have a managed object context because I don't know what database to look in. Okay, so now all we need to do is request. Okay, we just need to have a request, which is an NS fetch request. Okay, it's going to be what? What entity is going to be in this table? What does this MVC show? What kind of things? Twitter users, right? It's showing all the Twitter users that are mentioned this in this tweet. So this is Twitter user. Okay, now how about the predicate? Okay, we need a predicate of this for this thing. And so that's NS predicate, predicate with format here. Okay, so what is going to be our predicate for this? Well, this is a little kind of complicated, actually, if you think about it. We'd really want to get all the Twitter users who have a tweet that contains that string. And it turns out you can do that very straightforwardly with NS predicate. You're just going to say any tweets whose text contains, case insensitively, please, that mention. Okay. Now, I have to do percent at sign whenever anything that I'm doing here is not a reserved keyword. So I have to do percent at sign and then put it here in this var args. So this is our mention right there. Now, that's an optional, so I need to exclamation point here. But I need to be careful here. What if this mention is nil? This is going to crash. And mention is part of my public API. You should not have objects where people can set your public API to something that will crash internally. Okay? That's a bad API design. So I want to check right here by saying where this mention, and actually I also don't want to look up if the mention is empty string. That doesn't make any sense either. So I'm going to say mention.characters.count is greater than zero. So I'm using where here with this if, and this is kind of interesting. Look, mention characters count. If mention is nil, this whole thing is going to be nil, and the greater sign operator knows that nil is never greater than zero. It also knows nil is never less than zero, nor is nil equal to zero, okay? So it knows all those things, so it's kind of fun. You can put nils on the sides of these greater than and less than. It really kind of makes your code read nicely here, okay? Now, the last thing we need to do is sort, okay? So we need our sort descriptors, and remember that's an array of sort descriptors because we can sort by last name first, then first name, or by section name, and then by something else. But here we only have one sort descriptor, okay? The sort descriptor has numerous things that you can specify in its initializer. We're just going to use the simplest one here, which is I'm going to search by the key screen, sort by the key screen name. So we're going to list our users by their screen name, you know, their at sign, whatever. That's going to be the order of this table. And I'm going to have it be ascending true. So capital A's will be first all the way to capital Z, then lowercase a all the way down from there. Okay, so that's the only thing I'm going to search by. This one sort, or sort by, this is this one sort descriptor. Okay? So now, that's it. The only thing I have to do now is implement myself a row at index path, and I'm good to go. Okay? Because this is going to always be keeping the Twitter users associated with the rows. All right, so self a row at index path, of course, we need to set our reuse identifier, which I think was Twitter user cell, right? And it says configure the cell. Now, obviously, to configure the cell in any row, I need to know what Twitter user is in that row. Okay, so how do I do that? Let Twitter user equal, and I'm going to ask my fetched results controller. Okay, I'm going to say, what is the object that's at this index path? Okay, remember this is cell for row at index path, so index path is what the row we're talking about here. And I'm just going to ask the Twitter, I'm going to ask my fetch results controller what it is. And of course, it better be a Twitter user. So I'm going to put adds Twitter user there and say if let. Okay? So if I'm able to get the Twitter user here, then I can just do, for example, cell.textlabel.text equals the Twitter user's screen name, let's say. Okay? Now, there's a problem with this line of code right here. Can anyone guess what this problem is right here? Looks perfectly fine, right? This is accessing the database. Okay? And we know that anytime we access the database, we got to put it inside perform block. Okay? So we actually have to put some context here, perform block, okay, around this code. Now, what context are we going to use here? We could use our managed object context. That's true, and that would be fine. I'm actually going to use a different context. I'm going to use the Twitter user's managed object context. Every NS managed object, this is a Twitter user, okay, but we also have tweet. Every NS managed object knows the managed object context it's in, and you can ask it. That will often keep you from having to have var managed object context as public var, because you'll have some other var, which is a Twitter user or a tweet or something like that. And when that gets passed to you, now you know the managed object context. Got it? So that makes it so you don't have to pass both a managed object context and a Twitter user or something. Because if you're passing a Twitter user, you're passing the context along. Okay? So I'm just going to use that down in here. I'm doing this intentionally so that you know that this method exists. It's a really cool var. On an NS managed object. Now this is still no good. Okay? What's wrong here? What's going on right there? That's accessing the UI. That can only happen on the main queue. Okay? This, I happen to know, is the main queue. Okay? I know. But what if I was writing my code to truly be multi-threaded NS managed object context? I couldn't count on that. Okay? So I can't do that. So instead, I'm going to create a little var here, screen name, okay, which is going to be a string. And inside here, I'm going to get rid of this and say screen name equals that. And then out here, I'm going to set this equal to screen name. Okay? But there's still a problem with this. Anyone guess what this problem is? You're a quiet crowd today. This is asynchronous. Okay, that screen name is going to happen some other time. Certainly not in time for this. Okay, so we need to perform block and wait here. Okay, we have to wait for this to happen before we can do this. Got it? Okay, so that's it. Let's go ahead and run, see what this looks like. All right, let's look for Stanford again. Okay, we got 206 tweets. We had these too many Twitter users. I'm going to click this tweeters right here. And sure enough, look, here's all the people who tweeted hashtag Stanford that we've ever seen. Now, this is not quite exactly what we want. It's close, okay? Notice our alphabetization. You see all the capital letters first, then all the lowercase letters. Really, I want interspersed, right? I want case-insensitive case-insensitive sorting as well. What else is going on here? Also, maybe some of these I don't like. Like, look at this guy, dark side dub 16. Okay, that sounds kind of evil. So I don't ever want dark side to appear in my results. Okay, so let's fix both of those things. Let's fix the sorting, and let's make sure dark side does not appear in our results. Okay, so how do we do those things? First, the sorting case-insensitively is quite easy. Okay, here's where our sort descriptor is right here. Here's the key. and here's the ascending right there. We can just add another argument here, which is the selector to use. Okay, and we use hashtag selector here. Selector. And the selector I'm going to use is NSStrings, has one called localize case insensitive compare right here. Okay? And so you guys remember this format for specifying a selector, right? So I'm just going to use this instead of the standard one, which is compare, which is not case insensitive. So that's going to fix our case insensitive sorting. Okay, it's just how we specify our sort descriptor. How about getting the dark side out of there? Well, what appears in that table is determined by this predicate. Okay, any tweets containing this currently. But I can say, and the screen name does not begin with, case insensitively, dark side. Okay, and again, I can't put anything but keywords in here, so I have to put it out here. Okay, like that. Because I just wanted to do this to show you that you can update this predicate to change what shows up in your table. This is what controls what's in the table. So now when we run, let me do hashtag Stanford. Okay, and now tweeters, we can see that the sorting is right, you see? Capitals and lowercase. And look, no dark side. Okay, this is only a light side query right here. All right? Now I have 5 minutes left. I'll show you one last other fun thing. See this subtitle right here? What if instead of saying subtitle, I wanted to say how many tweets this guy has tweeted? Right? So we're showing, these are all the people who have tweeted hashtag Stanford, you know, have mentioned hashtag Stanford in their tweets. How, I don't know how many. So tell me how many each of these, how many tweets this guy have done. All right, so to do that, I need another little function. Okay, it's going to be a private func. I'm going to call it tweet count with mention by Twitter user. And it's going to take a Twitter user. And it's going to return an int, optional, with how many times, how many tweets, a tweet count, where that Twitter user has mentioned that. So it's going to return the number that I want to show there. Okay? So what is this little guy going to look like right here? Well, I'm going to have a local variable, which is the count, which I'm going to return at the end. Okay? It's optional because maybe I won't be able to find the results. We'll see. And I'm going to get the user's managed object context again and perform block. And I better perform block and wait, okay? Because this is a method that's being called. It needs to return. It can't, it's got to do the work and have the result come back. So I'm just going to create a fetch request here, NS fetch request. And this time I'm searching for tweets. Okay, even though I'm inside the implementation of a Twitter user table, I'm now counting tweets. So now I'm doing a different fetch inside there for tweets. This is not the same fetch that's filling the table. This is kind of a little side fetch that I'm doing. And the predicate for that, okay, is an NS predicate, the format, and text. Okay, I want the text of the tweet to contain, case insensitively, the mention that we're talking about. And I want the tweeter to equal this user, okay, that's passed in here. So I need to have the mention, so that's our mention, self.mention we'll need, self.mention. And I'm just going to go ahead and unwrap that. I'm pretty sure this is not nil because I don't think this method would be called if our mention was nil because we never would have gotten into all the self or own index path and all the stuff we never would have gotten here. Some would say, oh, protect against this, but I actually think it's good to crash here because you'll find this bug if you ever call this when mention is nil, which it never should be at this point. And then the tweeter is just this argument, user. So you can say tweeter equals user and pass a Twitter user, okay, and restrict your results to that. So that's our result. So now I'm going to use that count thing that we talked about before. That's the user's managed object context. Count for fetch request, the request. Don't care about errors. It'll come back zero. That's fine. I'm going to return the count. Okay? Everyone see what I did there? I just did the request that I wanted. So now that I have this nice little guy right here, I can go here and say that my cell, I can actually say if let the count equal the tweet count mentioned by this Twitter user. Okay, so if I got a count, then I'm going to have the cell's detail text label, text equal, and then let's even be kind of cute and say if the count is one, I'm going to say one tweet. Otherwise, I'm going to say count tweets, plural. Okay? If I wasn't able to get it, then I'm just going to set the cells detail text label text to empty. Okay? Let's run that. All right, hashtag Stanford again, seems to be our favorite. Here it is right here, okay, tweeters, and there it is. Okay, a lot of people with one tweet, but here's someone with three tweets. Okay, there's someone with four tweets right there, another with four tweets. Now, the next obvious thing is to say, awesome, I want to sort this table by the people, the numbers of tweets. So the people who tweet a lot are at the top. Wouldn't that be a lot better than alphabetical? It sure would. But to do that, we would need a different schema. Okay, this is important because in your homework, you're going to be sorting by a numerical value right here. You've got to make sure you have a schema that supports it. Why would we need a different schema to sort this by the number of tweets? It's because of this. Okay, if we go back up here and look at our sort descriptor, okay, for this table, it's sorting by the screen name. This always has to be an attribute in this entity. Okay? The sort descriptor cannot be anything but an attribute in this entity. Well, Twitter user does not have an attribute which is that number. So I cannot sort by it. You see? And not only that, it would be very difficult for me to keep a number on my Twitter user that would be that because it depends on the mention. I'd have to have like a different Twitter user for every mention. So this schema that we've designed right here, which I will show you, this schema, is insufficient to have that table sorted by that number. You would need a different schema, a slightly more powerful schema. And really, the hardest thing about assignment 5 for you is probably designing that schema. Once you design that schema, look how incredibly it is easy to load these tables up with that core data table view. I mean, it's just like, it's trivial. Okay, so make sure you spend your brain power on assignment 5 getting a good schema, understanding what you're being asked to do, and then getting a good schema that supports that. Okay? You'll find the rest of assignment 5 is straightforward. Okay? All right, that's it. I will see you on Wednesday. We'll talk about the final project requirements, among other things.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.